welcome to another Battle Report. I'm Miranda. I'm here at the Las Vegas Open here in Las Vegas, Nevada. And I've coerced two fine gentlemen that's playing a game against each other. We've got Andrew here, and we've also got Emmanuel with Hand Cannon Online doing a Battle Report. So, Andrew, what are you playing today?
Today I will be playing some Cryx led by Deneghra 3.
Nice 50-point list against. What have you got, Emmanuel?
I'm actually pulling some of the Leyline's tech from Hand Cannon Online, and I'm playing Morvahna 2 in a very anti-Cryx way.
So, we'll have to see how it goes. And then you are also going to be doing something in addition to this battle report, yes?
That's correct. So we are going to record a podcast commentary that will tell you pretty much, hey, you know, start now, and you can play the video and listen to the commentary along with it and get some insider information.
When you don't want to hear my voice anymore.
Well, watch it with hers first and then listen to us.
So yes, you're going to be doing a 50-point game here, so we'll see how this goes. And don't forget to check their podcast commentary out on handcannononline.com. Cryx is being led by Deneghra, the Soul Weaver. She has a Scarlock Thrall, a Night Wretch, and a Leviathan. An Ogryn Bokur, the Devil Shadow Mutineers, Dougal McNail, Lord Rockbottom, a Pistol Wraith, Selena Rayfell and the Nis Hunters, Gregor Boomhaller and Company, two Soul Trappers, and the Wither Shadow Combine. Circle is being led by Morvahna the Dawn Shadow. She has a Warp Wolf Stalker and a Wold Watcher, a unit of Shifting Stones, a Black-Clad Wayfarer, a Gallows Grove, the Druids of Aboros with the Overseer, Una the Falconer with two Rotterhorn Griffins, Tharn Blood Trackers with Nuala the Huntress, two Bloodweaver Night Witches, and the Gatorman Witch Doctor. Cryx wins the starting role and decides to go first. They are playing the Steamroller 2015 scenario Incursion. Three flags have been placed. Cryx deploys with Deneghra in the center and the Nis and Boomhallers on the flanks. Morvahna deployed behind the front line with her Stalker. Deneghra is the prey target. Cryx turn one. Deneghra allocates one focus to the Night Wretch and the Leviathan. The Nis Hunters run up field. The Pistol Wraith runs up and embeds with the Nis. The Soul Trapper runs up as well, along with Dougal McNail. Boomhaller makes a call of defiance and issues a run order. They have four up tough this round. The Wither Shadow Combine runs up behind a wall. The Night Wretch runs up with Boomhaller and company. The Leviathan runs up near the wall. The Scarlock Thrall only moves up a bit, then uses Spell Slave to cast Deneghra's Grave Wind spell on the Warcaster. The Devil's Shadow Mutineers run. Lord Rockbottom activates and moves up. He then spends a coin to put Walk It Off on the Mutineers. This grants them tough this round. The second Soul Trapper runs up near the Wither Shadow Combine. Deneghra activates and flies up behind the Mutineers. Finally, the Ogryn Bokur moves up behind Deneghra. Circle, turn one. The Tharn Blood Trackers advance up field. The Druids also advance, but don't move their full distance. They then each summon vortexes to create clouds. The leader casts counter magic, and the Overseer casts elemental protection. A Bloodweaver Night Witch runs up behind a Druid cloud. The second Night Witch does the same. The black-clad wayfarer phase jumps to a shifting stone near the blood trackers. The Gatorman Witch Doctor moves up and casts Zombify on the druids, making them tough and undead for a round. A Rotterhorn Griffin is forced to run and moves up behind the druid clouds. Una moves up behind a building. She then spends 3 fury to cast Watcher. The second Rotterhorn Griffin riles and runs for 2 fury and moves behind another druid cloud. Morvahna activates and advances up behind a wall. She casts the World Watcher's animus, Earth's Blessing, on herself, so she cannot be pushed, knocked down, or made stationary. She spends 3 fury to cast Fog of War. The World Watcher walks up near Morvahna and casts his animus, Earth's Blessing, on himself. The World Watcher is also forced to stone form, putting him up to armor 21. The Stalker warps prowl, riles for 2 fury, and walks up into a druid cloud. Cryx, turn 2. Deneghra replenishes focus and does not allocate any this turn. The Nis Hunters activate and move up. 5 of the Nis target the World Watcher, but only 4 are in range. They hit on anything but double ones and make it. It's dice minus 7 for damage, and the Wold takes 1 damage to spiral 4. Another Nis attempts to shoot at a druid. He'll need boxcars to hit, and misses. Lord Rockbottom moves up and pays a coin to put Money Shot on the Devil's Shadow Mutineers. The Devil's Shadow activates and moves up. Morlin takes a shot at a druid, again needing double sixes. The attack misses. Zira attempts to shoot at a druid, but is out of range. Boomhauer and company issue a charge run order and make another call of defiance. The first Trollkin triggers the Watcher spell, and the Rotterhorn Griffin moves up, but does not attack. Another Trollkin moves up and triggers Watcher again. The second Griffin moves up and attacks the Trollkin. The Griffin only needs a 6 to hit, which is boosted. The attack hits hard enough to trigger a tough check, which the Trollkin makes. The remaining Boomhauer company finish running. Deneghra makes a ride-by attack and moves up, attempting to use Venomous Breath on a blood tracker, but the attack is out of range. Deneghra moves back her remaining movement and then feats. She immediately gains 7 soul tokens. A Pistol Wraith moves up. A Soul Trapper moves up near the Nis. The Wither Shadow Combine move up ahead of the wall. The Ogryn Bokur runs up to the other side of Deneghra. Dougal McNeil advances up near the Nis. The Leviathan walks up behind the Night Wretch. Another Soul Trapper runs up near Boomhauer and company. The Scarlock moves up behind a wall. Circle, turn 2. Morvahna leeches back up to 7 fury and spends 1 to upkeep Fog of War. Una leeches back up to 4 fury. A Gallows Grove places in front of a Boomhauer. Una activates and takes a shot at the knockdown Boomhauer. She hits on anything but double ones and makes it. It's dice minus 6 for damage, and she does no damage. She takes another shot at the same model and misses. She takes a final shot at the Boomhauer and hits. She boosts damage and hits hard enough to kill him. The Gallows Grove denies a tough check. Finally, Una casts Watcher. A Rotterhorn Griffin activates and advances toward a Boomhauer. He is forced to use the animus Acceleration, which allows an additional special action. The Griffin then performs the special action Shrill Shriek. Models within 2 inches take a power 8 damage roll. The druid is caught in the attack at dice minus 3. He dies. It's dice minus 8 on the Boomhauers. The first one is fine, as is the second, and the third, and the fourth. Acceleration kicks in, and the griffin shrieks again. The first Boomhauer dies outright. The second one takes no damage. The third triggers a tough check, but fails and dies. The fourth takes no damage. The second Rotterhorn Griffin advances toward a Boomhauer. He then makes a double-handed throw. He needs a 6 to hit and makes it. Each model rolls for their strength, and the griffin wins. The griffin attempts to throw at Moreland. He needs an 8 to hit and boosts. The attack makes it at dice minus 4 for damage and kills Moreland outright. The boom howler takes no damage. Morvahna activates and spends 2 fury to cast Carnivore on the Tharn Blood Trackers. The Blood Trackers activate and advance into the Nyss. The first Tharn attacks a Nyss, needing a 7 to hit and misses. Morvahna cuts for a reroll and takes 3 damage, which is transferred to the Stalker on Spiral 3. The reroll makes it and kills the Nyss outright. The next Tharn attacks and kills another Nyss. The Blood Tracker has Quick Work and targets Dougal McNeil, needing an 8. The attack hits and causes 4 damage to McNeil. Another Tharn attacks a Nyss, hits, and kills him outright. The next Tharn misses, and Morvahna cuts for a reroll. She takes 2 damage. The reroll hits and kills another Nyss. Morvahna heals for 1 damage. A Blood Tracker throws a javelin at a Nyss, who is hit and killed. The Nyss take a command check and pass. Another Blood Tracker throws at a Nyss hunter, but is just out of range. Another Blood Tracker throws at the same target and misses. Morvahna cuts for a reroll and takes 2 damage. The Tharn misses again. Reform kicks in and the Blood Trackers shift around. The Shifting Stones activate and teleport the Wold Watcher in front of the wall. The Wold Watcher activates and targets the Pistol Wraith with his Elemental Strike, needing a 9 to hit. It boosts the attack and makes it. It's straight dice on the Wraith and the Wold boosts. This kills the Pistol Wraith and creates a 3-inch forest in his place for 1 round. The Stalker activates and is forced to regenerate. He heals for 2. The Stalker casts the Animus Sprint on a Bloodweaver Nightwitch. He then moves back behind a Shifting Stone. The Blackclad Wayfarer advances in an attempt to base the flag, but is stuck behind the Blood Trackers. The Druids activate in advance. They each summon Vortex Clouds. The Leader casts Counter Magic, and the Overseer casts Elemental Protection. The Gatorman Witch Doctor advances and casts Zombify on the Druids again. A Night Witch activates and charges a Boom Howler. She needs a 5 to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 6 for damage, and the Trollkin dies. Grievous Wounds denies a tough check. Killing Spree kicks in, and she moves back 1 inch. Then Sprint kicks in, and she retreats behind the Druid Cloud. The second Night Witch charges a knockdown Boom Howler. Her attack automatically hits at dice minus 6, but causes no damage. She performs Blood Rituals and takes 3 damage to boost her second damage roll. Her second initial attack kills the Trollkin. Killing Spree kicks in and she moves back 1 inch in contact with the center flag. Circle scores 1 control point. Cryx, turn 3. Deneghra's 7 souls convert to focus. She does not allocate anything. The Nyss Hunters activate and 2 move up. Selena aims and shoots at a Blood Tracker, needing a 5 to hit. She makes it and kills the Blood Tracker. Morvahna heals 1 point, and the Soul Trapper collects a soul. Another aiming Nyss shoots at a Blood Tracker and kills her. Morvahna heals 1, and a Soul Trapper collects a soul. The Nyss in melee takes a swing, needing an 8 to hit. He makes it and kills another Blood Tracker. Another soul is collected, and Morvahna heals 1. The next Nyss targets a Tharn, needing an 8 with no aiming bonus, and misses. The last Nyss also shoots, needing an 8, but misses. Dougal McNeil advances up and targets the Blackclad with a grenade. It's just out of range and deviates 3 inches directly back and catches no one. Lord Rockbottom moves up and pays to put Money Shot on the Devil's Shadow Mutineers. The Soul Trapper transfers its souls to Deneghra. Deneghra activates and with Vengeful Spirits uses 2 souls to allocate 3 focus to 2 warjacks. She then makes a ride-by attack, moving 9 inches up. She makes a melee attack on the Blackclad, needing an 8 to hit. She boosts and hits. and kills him. She calls his soul. She buys an attack on a blood tracker, also needing an 8. She boosts to hit and makes it. This kills the blood tracker and calls another soul. Deneghra buys another attack on a blood tracker and boosts. This kills another blood tracker and calls another soul. She camps her remaining focus, putting her at armor 25. The Leviathan activates and aims at the Rotterhorn Griffin. With Fog of War, the Jack needs a 9 to hit. Jack boosts and makes it. It's dice minus 1 for damage, which the Jack boosts. The Griffin takes 6 damage to spiral 4. The Leviathan buys another shot, needing a 9, and misses. The Devil's Shadow charges the Griffin. Mar needs a 7 to hit and misses. Zira uses her pistol and needs 5s to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 3 for damage, and the Griffin takes 9 damage to spiral 1. Zira shoots again and makes it. She does enough damage to finish off the Griffin. Bloodbound takes effect, and Moreland is placed back into play. The Night Wretch activates and shoots at the Night Witch. It needs an 11 to hit because of Fog of War and boosts. The shot connects and kills the Night Witch. The Wither Shadow Combine moves up. Tremulous makes a dark fire attack at the Gallows Grove. It hits on anything but double ones and makes it. It's dice minus 4 for damage, and the tree takes 1 damage. Melovis also makes a dark fire attack on the tree and hits. This time the tree dies. Melovis collects a soul. The Ogryn Bokur walks up. The Scarlock moves up and attempts to cast Mortality on the Rotterhorn Griffin. It needs a 9 to hit and misses. Boomhauer and company issue a Call of Defiance and issue a charge run order. A Trollkin triggers Watcher, and the Rotterhorn Griffin moves away from the Boomhauer. This triggers a free strike, and the Trollkin hits. It's dice minus 3 for damage, and the Griffin takes 12 damage to spiral 1. The remaining Boomhauer company runs. The Soul Trapper runs to the far flag. Cryx gains 1 control point. Circle, turn 3. Morvahna leeches Fury back to full. A Fury is left on the Wold, but they don't frenzy. Fog of War and Carnivore drop. Una leeches back to full Fury. The stones activate and teleport Morvahna near the Rotterhorn Griffin. The Night Witch charges Moreland, needing a 7 to hit. She misses, and Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 3 damage. Now the attack hits and kills Moreland outright. Killing spree takes effect, and she moves to 0 with another attack. She hits and kills another mutineer. Killing spree triggers again, but the Night Witch can't quite reach Mar. The blood trackers advance to engage the remaining Nis and McNeil. The blood tracker on McNeil needs an 8 to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 4, which triggers a tough check, which he makes. The next blood tracker automatically hits McNeil and triggers another tough check. This time he fails. A blood tracker takes a shot at a Nis, but misses. Another blood tracker shoots at an engaged Nis, but also misses. Another blood tracker throws at a soul trapper, needing a 5 to hit, and makes it. This kills the soul trapper. The last blood tracker throws at Sylena and misses. Morvahna activates and uses her feat, Blood Sacrifice. She takes 9 damage and brings back 9 warrior models, which are placed back in formation. Una activates and heals 1 point to the spirit on the griffin. Una then takes a shot at a soul trapper and hits. This kills the model. She now takes a boosted shot at Mar with the Devil's Shadow and hits. It's dice minus 2, which Una boosts. This kills the last mutineer. Una takes a shot at Boomhauer and hits. His dice minus 6 for damage, which she boosts, and Boomhauer takes 4 damage. The Rotterhorn is forced to charge the Ogryn Bokur. The Druid Overseer allows the Griffin to be forced outside of Una's control area. He needs a 7 to hit and misses. Morvahna cuts to reroll and takes 2 damage, which she transfers to Spiral 5 of the Stalker. The reroll hits at dice minus 6, and the Bokur takes 1 damage. The second initial attack misses, and Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 3 damage. The reroll hits, and he boosts damage, killing the Bokur. The Griffin riles for 1 fury. The Druids advance in front of Morvahna. A Druid attempts to force bolt the Night Wretch, but misses. Another Druid does the same and also misses. And another Druid tries one more time and misses. The Overseer casts the Devouring on the Night Wretch. He needs a 7 to hit and misses. Morvahna cuts to reroll and transfers 3 damage to Spiral 1 on the Stalker. The reroll hits and it's dice plus 1 for damage. Morvahna cuts to reroll damage and transfers 1 damage to Spiral 1 on the Stalker. The reroll causes 8 damage to Column 1. The blast catches a member of the Withershadow Combine, but does no damage. The remaining druids summon vortex clouds. The Gatorman Witch Doctor advances up and zombifies the druids. The Stalker advances up and is forced to regenerate. He heals 2 points. The Wold Watcher advances and takes a shot at a Nis and boosts, needing a 10. The shot kills the Nis and creates a forest. The Watcher riles for 1. Cryx, turn 4. Deneghra gains 4 focus from the souls. Boomhauer activates and does his fell call Rage Howler. The black-clad wayfarer takes a command check and passes. The druids also pass their command check. Boomhauer moves up a bit and the rest shift to engage. One of them triggers a free strike which hits and kills the trollkin. A trollkin swings on the gallows grove, automatically hitting. The tree takes 2 damage. The next trollkin's attack finishes off the tree. Morvahna heals 1 point. The next trollkin attacks the blackclad, needing an 8 and hits. It's dice minus 1 for damage, and the blackclad dies. Morvahna heals 1 point. Lord Rockbottom advances and makes a spray attack at the blood tracker. This catches 2 blood trackers and Deneghra. He needs 8s on the blood trackers and misses the first one and second one, and also Deneghra. The Scarlock moves up toward the Nis and casts Ghost Walk on them. The Nis activate and advance into melee with the blood trackers. The Nis need 8s to hit them. The first one makes it and kills a blood tracker. Deneghra culls a soul. Selena needs a 7 to hit the Tharn, and makes it. This destroys the model. The next two Nis attack Nuala, needing an 8. They both miss. Deneghra activates and advances toward the Nis. This triggers 4 free strikes from the blood trackers. They need 7s to hit her. The first one makes it, but at dice minus 16, no damage occurred. The remaining blood trackers choose not to take strikes. She spends a soul to cast Mortality on the blood trackers. She needs a 7 to hit and fails. She boosts a melee attack on a Tharn, needing an 8, and hits. This kills the blood tracker and Deneghra gains a soul. Morvahna heals 1 point. Deneghra uses the soul to cast Mortality on the blood trackers again. This time, it succeeds. She buys an attack on a Tharn and misses. She buys another attack, which hits, kills, and culls another soul. Morvahna heals 1 point. Deneghra buys another attack on a Tharn and misses. She spends a soul to allocate 3 focus to the Night Wretch. The Night Wretch runs to the far flag. The Wither Shadow Combine activates and issue a charge order. Melovis charges the Griffin, Admonia charges the Night Witch, and Tremulous charges a Blood Tracker. Tremulous needs a 6 to hit and misses. Admonia needs an 8 to hit and misses. Finally, Melovis needs a 7 to hit. He boosts with the soul and makes it. It's dice minus 2 for damage, and the Griffin takes 12 damage to Spiral 2, which kills him. Morvahna heals 1 point. The Leviathan moves up and shoots the Wold Watcher. It needs a 5 to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 3 for damage, and the Wold Watcher takes 1 damage to Spiral 5. Cryx gains 1 control point. Circle, turn 4. Morvahna leeches Fury back to full. Una cuts for 1 Fury. The Night Witch activates and charges Boomhowler. She needs a 5 to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 6 for damage, and with Grievous Wounds, denies a tough check. Boomhowler dies. Killing Spree takes place and she attacks the next Trollkin. She hits but fails to exceed armor. Her second initial attack hits and she does no damage, so Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 3 damage. The reroll still fails to exceed armor. The Wold Watcher advances up to Melovis and boosts to hit, needing a 9. It makes it and the Wold boosts damage as well at dice minus 4. This kills Melovis and places a forest. The Wold swings on Tremulous, needing a 9, but misses. Una aims and targets Admonia with Birds of Prey. She needs a 6 to hit and boosts. The shot hits at dice minus 2, which she also boosts. It does 2 damage, so Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 3 damage, which is transferred to Spiral 5 of the Wold Watcher. The reroll still results in 2 damage to Admonia. Una shoots her again and makes it. It's dice minus 6, which she boosts, and this time she kills Admonia. The third shot targets a Trollkin, needing a 4, which makes it. She boosts damage at dice minus 6 and kills the Trollkin. Boomhowlers take a command check. They're fine. The Night Witch charges a Night Wretch. She uses Blood Rituals to boost the attack roll and takes 3 damage. The attack hits at dice minus 4. The Night Wretch takes 9 damage to Spiral 4. The Night Witch's second initial attack is on a Trollkin, which misses. Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 3 damage, which is transferred to Spiral 6 on the Wold Watcher. The reroll hits at dice minus 6 and kills another Trollkin. Life Drinker triggers and the Night Witch heals for 3. Killing Spree triggers and she moves up and attacks a Trollkin. The attack hits at dice minus 6 and kills another model. Killing Spree triggers again and she targets the Night Wretch, needing an 8. She performs Blood Rituals and takes 2 damage to boost the attack roll. She hits at dice minus 4 and does enough damage to kill the Bone Jack. The Druids advance toward the far flag. The first Druid fires a Force Bolt at the Leviathan, needing a 5 to hit. It connects and pulls the Helljack 2 inches toward the Druid. It's dice minus 8 for damage, and the Jack takes no damage. The next Druid also fires a Force Bolt and hits. The Jack is pulled 2 more inches and takes 3 damage to column 3. Another Druid casts Force Bolt and hits. The Jack is pulled 2 more inches. It takes 1 damage to column 2. The fourth Druid fires a Force Bolt and hits. The Helljack is pulled 3 inches and takes no damage. The Overseer casts Elemental Protection, and the Leader casts Counter Magic. The last Druid summons a Vortex. Morvahna activates and casts Lightning Strike on the Stalker to give him Sprint. She then advances 8 inches toward Una, and another 5 inches past her because of the Light Cavalry rule. The Stalker warps strength and charges the Leviathan, claw first. He needs a 6 to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 2 for damage, and the Jack takes 7 damage to column 2. The second attack also hits at straight dice. The Jack takes 10 damage to column 1. The Stalker forces another attack and hits with the sword. The Jack takes 8 damage to column 3. The Stalker buys another attack, which hits and finishes off the Jack. Sprint triggers and the Stalker moves back. The Shifting Stones activate and place upfield to be in the way. The Blood Trackers activate and shift to be in melee. Blood Tracker on Selena swings, needing a 9 to hit, but misses. The second Blood Tracker also misses Selena. Nuala attacks a Nyss, needing an 8, but also misses. Another Blood Tracker swings on a Nyss and misses. But this Blood Tracker hits and instantly kills the Nyss. The Blood Tracker on Tremulous needs an 8 to hit and misses. The second one on Tremulous also misses. The Gatorman Witch Doctor advances and casts Zombify on the Druids. There is no scoring this turn. Cryx, turn 5. Deneghra spends a focus to upkeep Grave Wind and does not allocate. The Nyss activate and swing on the Blood Trackers. The first one attacks Nuala, needing an 8 to hit and makes it. It's dice minus 2 for damage, and Nuala dies. The next Nyss rolls an 8 and hits a Blood Tracker, killing her. Finally, Selena attacks, needing a 7, and makes it. Deneghra advances, triggering 3 free strikes from Blood Trackers and a Druid. They all miss. Grave Wind triggers on the Druid, who is pushed 2 inches directly away. Deneghra bases a flag. She takes a melee swing on a Blood Tracker, needing an 8, which she boosts. The attack hits and kills the Tharn. This triggers a command check, which they fail. The Scarlock activates and runs toward the far flag. Lord Rockbottom advances forward and makes a spray attack on the Wold Watcher. The spray catches the Wold, a Druid, and a Shifting Stone. He needs a 4 to hit the Watcher and misses the giant stone in front of him. He does hit the Shifting Stone, and the Druid is immune to fire this round. It's dice minus 6 on the Shifting Stone, who takes no damage, but it is on fire. Tremulous activates and attacks the Wold. He hits at dice minus 4, causing 7 damage to Spiral 5. Cryx scores 1 control point. Circle turn 5. Morvahna leeches back to full fury. Una cuts for 3 fury. The Shifting Stone rolls to see if the fire goes out, and it does. Morvahna advances to base the flag. She spends 2 fury to heal. Una advances up and boosts a shot at the Scarlock. It connects, and she boosts damage and kills the Scarlock. The Druids advance up field, and the Overseer casts the Devouring on Lord Rockbottom. He needs a 4 to hit and makes it. It's dice plus 1 for damage. This triggers a tough roll for Rockbottom, who fails. A Druid targets Tremulous with Force Bolt. In melee, he needs a 9 to hit the back arc. The attack makes it and causes 4 damage to Tremulous, who is also pulled 3 inches toward the Druid. The next Druid targets Tremulous, only needing a 5 to hit, and makes it. He does not damage, so Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 1 damage, and the reroll still does no damage. The next Druid needs an 8 and misses. Morvahna cuts to reroll. She takes 2 damage, and the reroll still does no damage. 2 Druids cast Summon Vortex, and the leader casts Counter Magic. The Wold Watcher advances toward Tremulous and boosts an attack, needing a 9. The attack connects at dice minus 4, which the Wold boosts. This kills Tremulous and creates a pretty forest in his place. A Night Witch activates and runs to the center flag. The Gatorman Witch Doctor moves up and casts Zombify on the Druids again. The stones place in and around the center flag. The Stalker activates and warps Prowl and moves into the wreck marker. The Blood Trackers take another command check, and they rally. Circle scores 2 control points. It is now 3-3. At this point, there is no way Cryx can beat Circle, since Deneghra only has 3 Nyss left. Cryx concedes the game, and we have a Circle victory. Please stay tuned for our post-battle discussion as we discuss the game a bit more in depth. And don't forget to like and subscribe to my channel. If you'd like to stay up to date with all things WarGamerGirl, you can follow me on Facebook. And if you'd like to help support my videos, you can do so on Patreon. Okay, now for the discussion. And welcome to our post-battle wrap-up here at Awesome LVO 2015. You can see his last day kind of winding down. We had Andrew and Emmanuel fighting in that 50-point game of Cryx versus Circle. So let's just get your thoughts on it here. List construction. Andrew, Emmanuel, where were you coming from with your lists?
So right up front, my name's Emmanuel, obviously, from Hand Cannon Online, from the Leyline, Removed from Play, and also one of our guest hosts from Removed from Play as well. So, you know, we got a little bit of experience playing into these various matchups, and my list was very centered around what Morvahna would need to be into Cryx, especially modern Cryx, where there's a lot of guns and there's a lot of debuffs. So Druids were the first place I started. I knew I wanted the counter magic, I wanted the clouds for line of sight blocking, and you know, sometimes with Carnivore they can actually kill Cryx troops because the POW 10 is all you really need, and it's a good way to steal some health back. And after that, I put in the Bloodweaver Night Witches. They're amazing. Anti-Tough is great on Bane Thralls. And then overall, they can just eat through a whole lot of troops. I changed my battle group from the normal Stalker Gorax list and added a Watcher. Give me an extra Shield Guard, but it also gives me magical weapons. His fists are magical weapons, so they can hit incorporeal models. His gun is magical, which actually comes up in the game because I get to shoot a pistol ray and turn it into a forest. And then from there, it's just kind of filling with typical things that Morvahna likes. But there's one choice that I made that I really like, and I think that people should explore more. People get caught up so much with playing troops and Morvahna that they assume that's all she can do, but her rerolls are really powerful on anybody with a gun. So I included my Una and Rotterhorn package because the Rotterhorns are good for scenario. They have two open fists, they can throw things around. Screeching is really good against Cryx, and Defense 14 is a great stat line against a lot of their lower mat. And then she is able to, with Bird's Eye, sit behind blocking terrain or pretty much anything that Cryx wants to be, you know, trying to cross to charge, and she can just keep shooting three guys a turn. She does a lot of work, and Watcher will really surprise people. When they try to charge in a bunch of Banes on a target, the first Bane comes in, and you'll kill it, and you'll move in front, and then they'll all have to attack the Defense 14 Watcher instead, and that's not something they want. So there's a lot of good gambits, and it was definitely teched for what if Morvahna Cryxed.
Oh, all right then. So then, on your side, as a Cryx player...
So my list was basically built. I just took my Denny 1 list, threw Denny 3 in it. It was primarily supposed to be my Cryx drop, but I'm trying to play it into like everything I can really right now.
Yeah. Projected.
Yeah. So it just starts off with just my Denny 1 list. I take out the my second arc node, and in with a Shadow Combine and Crystal Wraith, some more stuff to just get souls moved around for Denny.
Well, that's the whole soul train theory,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, keep the soul train rolling. So, she gets souls, helps her get more souls.
So the important elements to that were, like with her Shadow Combine.
Yeah. With the Shadow Combine, like, you had a bunch of stealth, so it didn't really turn in that much.
So you had a lot of guns, and the guns versus my stealth was a big deal. Also, you have the Devil Shadows Mutineers, right?
And the Mutineers are cool.
Gorgeous.
They're
amazing.
And then the Leviathan, why use that one?
It really likes being full of focus, and
that's true.
Denny can fill it up with the her, one of her soul abilities.
Soul just Weaver.
Spend a soul and mastery. Fill it up with focus.
Yeah. That one's sweet. That's,
yeah.
And it's like one of the best jacks in Cryx, I think.
Agreed. And giving it a full focus load, allowing it to aim and just plug shots and stuff is always scary.
Oh, yeah.
So then, from there, you won the starting role?
Yes.
So
I chose to go first.
So why did you choose to go first? I thought that was really interesting.
As a Cryx player, I'm used to like wanting to go first, just get as much free board as I can, and start like posturing to shoot people. Didn't really turn out to be that great in this matchup because you had a bunch of stealth and stuff I couldn't really reliably hit, like Def 18 Druids.
Yeah, you don't really have like AoEs or anything to make up for that, so it's just shots.
Yeah, it's just single shots. Danny does have a spray on her mount, but it's not going to be
used. And the Druids are shutting down a lot of your spell casting.
Yeah, I can't get mortalities out there like I really want to.
Yeah.
As a pro tip, it's generally better to always allow the circle player to go first in most cases, unless they have a ton of AD. Mostly because if they get the chance to score first, that is momentum that they can keep pushing and keep pushing. Yeah. You think of like Kruger 2 and Morvahna and Bradagus.
Very strong scenario.
Yeah, it's very strong scenario casters. And so allowing them the chance to go first or destroy your objective first or be in the zone and prevent you from scoring are all things you have to consider.
Okay.
Fair enough. So after that, though, you also had Deneghra sort of stayed kind of to the side for the most part. I mean, you know, she was centrally located originally, but you kind of ended up...
You both ended up sort of
hitting opposite sides.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know Morvahna was trying to stay away.
So my biggest plan in this, and it's one of my favorite plays with Morvahna, I call them gambits because I play a lot of chess, and so I try to associate the same chess gambit. And one of the easiest ones to do with Morvahna is just to allow your opponent to get a few control points, because almost always they will find themselves getting overconfident and thinking, if I can just clear the flag a few more times, I can win. That is extremely hard against a caster who can completely repopulate her army anywhere she wants, in and around your lines.
That's a big weakness in this matchup for me, is I have no RFP at all.
And then adding tough on top of that and undead just makes removing a bunch of models and hard. Plus, as I make more attacks and your list starts to dwindle, you have less attacks to remove those models.
Yeah.
And so Colin Hill once explained it, where essentially Morvahna moves up and she kills some of your stuff. You kill half of her army. Whatever is left kills half of your army, but then she feeds and puts it back, and your half can't finish off her whole army. And so I definitely plan to play on the scenario. I wanted to give you a few points, and I'll let you get kind of jammed in on the flags, and then orbit 16 inches or so away from your caster. That way, there's not many ways for you to get attacks on Morvahna.
Well, and you were camping a lot the whole time.
Yes.
On top of that.
Exactly.
Because if she did reach you,
it's really threats a long ways.
Yeah, she threats very far, and then there's a lot of different ways to engineer attacks through bouncing attacks and through sprays. And I considered all of those and just went, the safest route is to, if I'm going to play it between 1 and 6 hit points during the whole game, I just need to camp all of my fury.
Fair enough, fair enough. And then you kind of kept the stalker even as mostly as a sink for your damage.
He's really just the end game piece. I want something that can kill a caster, so stalkers are good at that.
Yeah.
But I also really wanted something that would be able to facilitate Scales of Fate, because it's her strongest ability. She's got a great feat, she's got a great spell list, but being able to reroll bad dice rolls is such a swing on the attrition curve. So I just keep the stalker near my stones or near her, and I transfer as many of those Scales of Fate to it as I can, and then I use Hyper Regeneration and then my stones to just keep clearing off that damage from her and from him, and it allows me to play a very aggressive reroll game.
Fair enough. Plus, even as he's killing your army, you're healing from that too.
Exactly, exactly.
And then your Soul Train, where did the Soul Train stall out, I guess?
So, during that turn when Denny, like, could not hit any attacks. she needs some HP, boosts some. She gets one or two, puts Mortality up, starts needing sixes, doesn't get them.
Yeah. Sixes can be tricky.
It was interesting. I really thought after the Mortality went on that was just going to be the end of me jamming her down, and I was going to have to come up with a new plan.
Yeah. If I roll average, I probably clear off almost all of the ring you put around her.
I was hoping that you would spend more focus and go down further and say, if I just clear off everybody, I'm fine.
But then Stalker comes into me.
The Stalker's just waiting for you to drop that focus so he can come on. Once you get under the arm 23 curve, he's coming for you.
And also you had arm 27, I think, at one point?
At one point, yeah.
Yes, he did. He's like, you want to kill me? Mm-mm, no.
Like, worse than Terminus.
I've seen Terminus hard.
Yeah.
They can both get to those extreme camps. Yeah. Denny just facilitates it on her own, where Terminus is more reliant on his opponent to facilitate his armor.
Sure.
Denny can just feat and then not do anything like I did and be at arm like 30 if you don't spend anything, I think.
So for your list facing him again, what would you change out for your Denny 3 list if you're stuck with still Denny 3?
I think the Boom Howlers weren't the best choice in this because you had the tree and all the Grievous Wounds to just take them off
denying
the table.
Denying toughs, yeah.
Not many of them got up there to make attacks until like turn 3.
Yeah, I think the Boom Howlers are a good choice versus hordes in general, especially when you plan to kill some beasts. Rage Howl can be a big deal, and they can really get jammed in. But against this list, there was so much anti-healing that you made very few tough checks because I didn't let you.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even just one Gallows Grove. And then the, what were they, the Night Witch, or Blood Witch?
The Blood Weaver,
the Blood
Night Witch.
Yes, the new solo.
Those gals are crazy. I love their pose, they remind me of She-Ra.
Yes, they're great. And the great thing about all of them is they're solos, so Morvahna doesn't need to feed them back into anybody's command range. They can literally be anywhere, and they can get out there and do work, and then once your opponent commits to killing them, because they don't want you to killing spree through them a second time,
right.
You feed them back into precarious situations where you go, okay, if you want to come in and kill this thing, they're just going to do it again next time.
Yeah.
Or one of my favorite gambits is to put it behind the enemy's caster, and then put models on the inside of their line to insulate them from going and killing it, so that way the following turn he can poke Grievous Wounds and then she can spell assassinate them.
Alright, well I think we should probably wrap it up here. Do you guys have any closing thoughts for your game today?
Interesting match. Both interesting casters, very complex and a very, very long game, right?
Yes, very grindy, very long.
Not that you guys will see that. Alright, well thank you guys so much for joining me today. I hope you're enjoying the Las Vegas Open.
Yes.
And I hope to definitely see you guys
again
on my channel.
One of the best cons of the year.
Thank you guys. Bye.